Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at God in His Son. God in His Son. God in His Son speaks to us. The person of Christ is a great mystery. There are many different aspects of the definition of Christ. Actually, that's why the scripture enjoys that we grow in the knowledge of Christ, because as we grow in His knowledge, the definition is not changing, because the definition is unsearchable. It's just revealing it. Another dimension of this definition. So if we were to ask, or if someone were to ask, who is Christ? People would say, oh, Christ is our Savior. He died on the cross. Another people would say, yes, He died on the cross, but yet today is our High Priest. Another person will define Christ to say He's the creator of all things. So today we are looking at another aspect of the definition of Christ, that is God in His Son. God in His Son, because Himself is God. The Bible is about God in His Son. Essentially, the summary of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is God in His Son. God in His Son in creation. God in His Son in the fellowship with Adam in the cool of the day. God in His Son in His restoration plan to restore man back to Himself. God in His Son incarnating in the flesh. God in His Son living as a God man on the earth in His earthly ministry in the four gospel. God in His Son dying for man, being a ransom for man. God in His Son resurrecting from death. God in His Son in ascension. God in His Son in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So essentially all through the Bible, God in His Son in the kingdom, in the millennium, God in His Son in eternity past. So God has no greater gift than Himself in His Son. There is no greater gift. God has nothing else to give us higher than Himself. And you can never find God outside of Christ. We find God in His Son. So when we talk about God in His Son, we are talking about the very being of God Himself. In Christ, and it is through Christ God is able to minister Himself to us. God has given Himself to us through Christ. God has made Himself real to man through Christ. God has made Himself tangible to man in the person of His Son. That's why we celebrate what God has done for us in Christ. That is why we are glad. Our hearts, our praises, we are making melody in our hearts to the Lord. So God has no greater gift than Himself in His Son. He has a lot of gifts He could give, but the greatest of the inheritance He could give to us is Himself in His Son. What a joy. God has not committed our salvation to anyone aside Himself in His Son. So God could trust nobody with our salvation. God could not entrust salvation to no one aside Himself in His Son. This is why the Lord is our salvation. God Himself is our salvation in His Son. No man can approach God. God dwells in unapproachable light. No one has seen God except the Son, who dwells in the bosom of the Father, as John 1:19 tells us. So no one can approach God. No one can see God. No one can meet with God outside the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. So God has not committed our salvation to anyone outside Himself in His Son. The gospel is God and His Son coming to man. The gospel, salvation, the grace of God is the grace of God that appeared to all men is simply the grace of God that brings salvation that appeared to all men is simply God in His Son coming to man, which is the incarnation of Christ, which is the manifestation of God in the flesh. What a joy. The gospel is God in His Son coming to man. God is only found in His Son. You will not find God outside of the Son. That's why the Son was able to say that, look, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you know me, you know the Father. There's no Father outside of me. That's my interpretation of what John 14 was saying there. So God is only found in His Son. You will not find God outside. Any God you find outside the Son, I don't think is the true and living God. The true and living God is in the Son. That's why the Son is the way to God, because there's no other way to God apart from the Son. What a joy. The Son is God from God, because we see this in Hebrews chapter 1 as well, verse 8, where the Father said as to the Son, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The mystery. Remember again, I say the definition of Christ is numberless. It's as we come up here, He reveals a different dimension, a higher dimension of Himself to us. This is why we grow in His knowledge. So another definition of Christ is God from God. God in God. God in His Son. What a joy. The Son is God in His approachable form. So we can say technically we have God in, allow me to use the expression, in an unapproachable form. This is because the scripture said that God dwells in unapproachable light. God dwells, the Father dwells in unapproachable light. No one has seen the Father except the Son. So we can technically borrow those two scriptures and say God, we have the unapproachable form of God, which we can say essentially is the God that dwells in unapproachable light. Then we have the approachable form of God, which is God manifested in the flesh, God tabernacle among men, God making himself real to us, but in his Son. So the Son is God in his approachable form. What a joy. God in his Son is our salvation. So our salvation is not just in anything distinct from God. Our salvation is not distinct from God. Our daily salvation is an experience of an indwelling God, the God in his Son. So our salvation is what? Is God in his Son. What a joy, what a joy. Because we don't have three gods. We don't have a separate God of God as the Father, or a separate being of God as the Father, as God as Son, God as Spirit. God is one, all through scripture. Here is where the Lord your God is one. He's one, but he's triune. How? Is a mystery. There are three that bear records in heaven. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one. So we have God in his Son as the Spirit inside of us. What a mystery. It is in his Son God relates with man. God will have no relationship. God will have no communion. God will have no interaction with any with fallen man outside the Son. So it is in his Son God relates to us. So the Son, we could say, is the interface between God and man, the mediator between divinity and humanity. What a joy, what a joy. Hallelujah to the Lord. God will have no relationship with any creature outside except through his Son. He will not. He is not interested. He doesn't really understand the language of fallen man, because the fallen man is an abomination to the Lord, because he said that all our righteousness are filthy rags before him. So the only basis of communion, of relationship, of interaction, of exchange, of any mode of communication with God is in his Son. This is why the Son said, I am the way. I am the way, the way. There's only one way to God, and that is the Son. What a joy, what a joy. So God will have no relationship with man except through his Son. The Son is not just the Son. Again, you said, we said we're looking at one of the definitions of Christ. The definition of Christ are numberless. The scripture calls it the unsearchable riches of Christ. It says no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son. So the Son is not just the Son, but the Son is the Son with the Father. Oh, that's a different ball game entirely. The Son is not just the Son. The Son is the Son with the Father. So when we are meeting the Son, we are meeting the Father in the Son. When we are honoring the Son, we are honoring the Father in the Son. Oh, hallelujah to the Son of the living God. That's why I said, those who receive him, receive not just him, but him that sent him. When the Son speaks, it is as one that the Father is dwelling inside. It is as one in whom is the Father. So when he's speaking, when the Word of God is coming to us, it is not just like any word of human intellect, but this is as the Word embodied, the embodiment of God himself. What a joy. So it is as one in whom is the Father. So our definition, the lens through which we see the Son, God will help us to use a higher dimension of lens to begin to see the Son. Some see the Son as, oh, the son of Joseph, a carpenter. He was here. Like some people of other religions say that he was just a prophet. That's the lens they have. We in Christianity, we say, no, that is the very God himself. God is in him. That is our more to God. When the Son walks, it is as one indwelt by the Father. He said, I cannot on my own self do nothing. And he also said that the works that he does is the Father in him, John 14, that does the work. So when the Son is walking, and the Son has not stopped walking, because he said the Father walketh and I too must walk. So the Son is still walking. It's just that it's not just in the physical earthly ministry as it was during the four gospel, but he's still walking as our great high priest, a billion times busier than he was while he was here on earth. The person of God is not separate from the person of the Son. That's where we're going to. The person of God is not separate, because the Lord himself said it, I and the Father are one. He who has seen me has seen the Father. I am in the Father and the Father is in me. So the person of God, so meeting God is meeting the Son. Rejecting the Son is rejecting the Father. So the person of God is not separate from the Son. also, the Son is the visibility of God, is the image of the invisible God. The Son is the tangibility of God. The Son is the reachability of God. The Son is the approachability, if there's such a word like that. So the Son is the visibility of God. God is invisible, because it said Christ, Colossians 1, I think, which is the next slide, talks about the Son. Who is the image? Colossians 1:15. Who is the image of the invisible God? The firstborn of every creature. The image of the invisible God. So even Isaiah 45:15 talks about God hides himself. God, you are the God that hides himself, oh God of Israel, our Savior. So he is the image of, so he is the visibility of God, he is the tangibility of God. We meet with God in the Son. Outside the Son, God has no means to reach man. Man has no means to reach God. Without the Son, God cannot reach man. Man cannot reach God. That is the design of God. Our opinion was not sought. The Godhead's design is that for man to reach God is going to be through the Son, who is the way to God. And for God to reach man is going to be through the Son. That's the way God has designed it, going by scripture, that God was an unapproachable light and God was manifested in the flesh. So the workings of God, the doings of God is always in his Son. So without the Son, we have no hope of reaching God. God is forever hidden to us. But what a joy for what the Son has done for us. God speaks to us in his Son, Hebrews chapter 1, that the Father, God who has sundry times spoke to our fathers by the prophet, as in this day is speaking to us in his Son. So God, the Son, being the eternal word of God, is the medium of communication of God to man. Don't say the Son was not in the Old Testament. The Son is in the Old Testament, but in that dispensation, it was the dispensation of the Son in types and shadows and in prefigures. So let's not get it that God in his Son has been speaking from eternity, because the Son is the word that was with God, that is with God, and that is God himself. So God speaks to us in his Son. God sanctifies us in his Son. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. And the Son said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The truth is just the very person of Christ himself. Christ is the truth. He is the spirit of truth. So God sanctifies us through Christ as the word, through Christ as the truth. God in his Son is our Savior. We do not have two saviors, especially when we go through Timothy and Titus. We see description of God our Savior. Also, in other verses, Christ our Savior. Do we have two saviors? God our Savior, Christ our Savior. It's because God in his Son is our Savior. So the Son as our Savior is God as our Savior. So God in his Son is our Savior. God in his Son is our Redeemer. God in his Son is our Apostle. So we go through a list of things, just a few list of things that God in his Son is to us. So when we are saying that we are abiding in Christ, we are not just abiding in Christ alone, we are also abiding in God in Christ. Because he said, I and the Father will make our abode with them. So you always see those, even salutations of most of the epistles, is always towards the God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. God and his Son is our wisdom. It is of God that we are in Christ Jesus, who is made unto us wisdom from God. So God and his Son is our wisdom. We don't lose sight of that. That wisdom is a person. The personality of wisdom is just the very being of God in his Son, who is the power and the wisdom of God. God and his Son is our righteousness. As I said, their righteousness is of me. God and his Son became a sin for us, so that we through his righteousness can become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So God in his Son is our, the righteousness that we have today is the righteousness of God in his Son. So it is God who is working all in all. So let's not think that the Father is distant from the workings of the Son. It is God in his Son working in our life. What a joy. God in his Son is our deliverer. He's our deliverer. He delivered us from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of his dear Son. Is he still delivering us today? Yes, from every work of darkness, delivering us from every plan of the enemy. Because we are almost in a territory whereby the enemy is just trying to make, going to and fro, trying to raise, unnecessary things. But what a joy that God and his Son is our deliverer from any evil. What a joy. God and his Son is our life. So whatever Christ is to us is actually God in his Son being to us. So God in his Son is everything to us that Christ is to us. Like Colossians 3 mentioned, for that Christ who is our life, in him we live, we move and have our being. That for us to live is Christ. So God in his Son is our our life. I have come that they may have life. God in His Son is our strength. Hallelujah. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. God in His Son is our strength. It's the indwelling power that is within us. Said according to the power that worketh in us. So God in His Son is our strength. God in His Son is our King, our eternal King, the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the God who alone is wise. To Him be glory forever and ever. That means we do not just have a priest, a high priest in Christ. We also have a King in the person of Christ as well. A King essentially oversees the affairs of these people, the protection of the people, the well-being of the people, and He has even made us kings and priests unto Himself. So God in His Son is our King as well. God in His Son is our light, the true light that lights any man that comes on the earth. God in His Son is our light. That is the light of the world. God is light. God is light, and in Him there is no variableness. So God in His Son is our light. So in any situation, darkness could represent uncertainty. I mean, when there's no clarity on the season you are in the project you are going to, but we pray to God in His Son, which is towards the end of where we talk about how we behold God in His Son, that God in His Son is our light. So the light that God gives to us is just Himself. Light is the very person of God. God is light. God in His Son is our refuge, our high tower, our secret place, the place where we run to, our armor. God in His Son is our refuge, our strong tower. What a joy. There is no refuge like Christ. There is no refuge like God in His Son. So we have not a physical refuge per se, but it's a realm. It's a sphere we are living that in Him we live, we move, and have our being. God in His Son is also our vine. God in His Son is also our glory. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Glory is the manifestation of God. Glory is when God is made manifest in an environment. So we are the glory of God in Christ Jesus because God is made manifested through our life. So God in His Son is our glory. God fellowships with us in His Son. 1 Corinthians 1:9 said that God is faithful, who has called us into the fellowship of His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. So God interacts with us in His Son. It is through His Son that is able to fellowship with us. Outside of His Son, there's no fellowship between God and man. God dwells in us in His Son. And that John 14:23, when the Lord said, I and the Father will make our abode in Him, those who keep His word. So we can see the joy that we have, that we do not just have one third of the Godhead in us, like maybe I used to think years back, to think, oh, it's just Christ, maybe it's just the Spirit, maybe it's just God. But now I'm growing in it. I don't want to say I have to understand. Does anyone ever understand everything about God today? Say God is far beyond what our understanding can produce. So we have God in His Son who is inside. So because the Son is in me, God the Father is in me, God the Son is in me, God the Holy Spirit is in me. What a joy. So God dwells in us in His Son. God is nothing to us outside His Son. So let's not think there is a title or there is a value or something that God is to us outside His Son. Always it is through Christ as the way. It is through Christ as the means. Christ is always the channel of God. Everything God is doing regarding our salvation, Christ is the very channel He's using. God was in Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself. So God was in Christ. So God is still in Christ sanctifying us as our high priest, nourishing us, cherishing us, transforming us, conforming us to His glorious image. What a joy, what a joy. I am in the Father, John 14, and the Father in me. And of course, all through John 14, 15, 16, 17, especially in 17, He was praying it, I in you, I in them, I in them. God is in Christ, and Christ is in God. Mystery. I am with the Father and the Father is in me. A coherence and a coexisting relationship whereby both are dwelling. I don't want to use both because it might tend to mean like you're talking of two separate people, but of course there are no human language to convey some of this. To we just go by what the scripture says, that He said, I and the Father are one. So I am in the Father and the Father in me. Very mysterious. God in the Son is our Father. That's why the Son is even called the Eternal Father in Isaiah 9:6, that God in His Son is the Father, is the Eternal Father, the Abba Father. Our height is crying to us. Galatians 4:6 says that God has put the Spirit of His Son in our hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. God in His Son is the Spirit. Oh, this blessed me a lot. I'm very grateful to God. Because you are looking at it, is the Spirit of God a different person, entirely separate from the Son, separate from the Father? But looking at that, God in His Son is actually the Spirit. That's why when the Spirit, when the 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, now the Lord is the Spirit. And even when Christ called Himself the Spirit as our high priest in Revelation 2:3, that he that has a hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. Now it's breaking, it's getting clearer that, God in His Son is the Spirit. Hallelujah. Please, more revelation of this. So, God in His Son is the Spirit. All the Father has and He is the Son, He has and He is as well. The Father, all the wealth the Father has, like the Lord said in John 16, that everything the Father has, all the Father has is His. So, all the Father is our Father, it is through Christ. The Father is our sanctifier, it is through Christ. The Father is our shepherd, it is through Christ. The Father is our Savior. Everything the Father is to us is actually through the Son is to us. And that's why the scripture calls the Son our Savior, also calls the Father our Savior. What a joy, what a joy. Hallelujah. We behold God in His Son. So we behold God in His Son continually. So the God we behold, they said as we, 2 Corinthians 3:18, that as we behold Him as in a glass in a mirror, we are being transformed from glory to glory. See, they look unto Him and they were lightened and they were not put to shame. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And He also draws attention. The Father draws attention to the Son. He said, no one can come to Me except the Father draws them. He said, come unto Me, all you that labor. He said, if any man thirst, let him come to Me. So we behold God in His Son. What a joy, what the joy. We worship God in His Son. Yes, sir. Hebrews chapter 1 of the Father, He said of the Son that let all angels worship Him. It's because God in His is in His Son. Hallelujah. The Muslims or those other, I know they might say Christ is just another prophet. That is what they, whatever myopic lens they are using to look at the Lord of glory Himself. So we worship God in His Son. And God actually accepts our worship that comes through His Son. That's why Hebrews 13 also talks about that we offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving to praise to God continually in His name through the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray to God in His Son. So our prayer to God, that's why the Son said that whatever you ask the Father in My name, in My name, in My person. So it is through the Son that we are able to pray to God. So we pray to God in His Son. So when we are praying to the God that is inside the Son. There is no God outside the Son, in my own opinion. I don't know, going by what I know today, but I don't see any parts in the scriptures where we will find God outside the Son. So I pray to God in the Son. Because the Father is in the Son and the Son is in the Father. We honor God in His Son. He said those who honor Him honor the one that sent Him as well. So when we are honoring Christ, when we are singing, making eulogies to the Lord, when we are making melody in our hearts to the Lord, we are also honoring God in His Son. What a joy. That's actually how God has designed to receive our praise, our prayers, our spiritual sacrifices. It is through the very person of the Son. We offer thanksgiving. I think I need to read that Hebrews chapter 13. I quoted Hebrews 13. Maybe I could go to Ephesians 5 then and maybe just take another scripture rather than reciting that again. Ephesians chapter 5, I could read from verse 17. Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians 5, what a joy to the glory of the person of Christ and His Son. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 19 and 20. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, because God Himself is dwelling in His Son. So we offer thanksgiving to God in His Son. What a joy. God is actually rejoicing over us because of Christ, because of what He has done in Christ for us. So we as well are rejoicing before God because of what He has made Christ to be to us, because of what Christ is doing in our life, has done, and we continue to do. God reveals Himself in His Son. So God is glorified in His Son. So God unveils Himself in His Son. The Son is the revelation of God, is the unveiling of God. It is the demystification of the mystery of the person of God. So God reveals Himself in His Son. That's why I said no one knows the Father except the Son. God manifests Himself in His Son. God was man. Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh. seen of angels, preached to the Gentiles, believed in the world, and received up into glory. Classic illustration of the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ towards man. So God manifests himself in his Son. That is, God makes himself real. God makes himself real as light, as the truth, as the word, as savior, as a deliverer in his Son. What a joy. God is glorified in his Son. God is glorified in his Son. That is, God is made tangible to man. That is, God is praised in his Son. God is adored, is eulogized in his Son. So God is glorified in his Son. It glorifies him. That's why in John 7:20 he was praying that glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. That God is glorified in his Son. What a joy, what a joy. God can only be found in his Son. God can only be found in his Son. You will not find God. No man will find God outside of the Son. This is why we all come to the Son, because he is the way to God. God is not outside of him. God is inside of him. So we go to the God in the Son. What a joy. God is everything to us in his Son. He's everything to us. He's our shelter. He's our living bread. He's our living water. He's our abode. He's our dwelling place. He's our righteousness. He's our savior, our advocate. God is a lot of things to us. It's our true vine. It's what? It's the living bread, the bread of life. What a joy. God is everything to us in his Son. God has no greater gift. We go back to where we started from. God has no greater gift than himself in his Son. He has no greater gift to give any man outside himself in his Son. So we rejoice before him. We thank God for what he has done for us in his Son. There is nothing greater than God himself. So when God gives us his Son, he has given us himself. When God brings us in union with his Son, he has brought us in union with himself. God has not committed our salvation to anyone outside himself in his Son. To no one has God committed our salvation. He doesn't trust anybody to get the job done apart from himself. What a joy, what a joy, what a joy. So in summary today, we've been able to look at God in his Son. We said that God is hidden in his Son. God hides himself in his Son. God is made manifest and real to us in his Son. God has no greater gift to give us than himself. God is everything to us in his Son. God can only be found in his Son. God will not be found outside his Son. So if you are looking for God outside of Christ, you are wasting your time. God is saying that, come unto me. The Son is saying, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. In fact, the Father himself is drawing people to Christ. God is glorified in his Son. What a joy. God manifests himself in his Son. God makes himself real and tangible to man through the very person of his Son. God reveals himself in his Son. There is no revelation of God outside of Christ. Christ is the very unveiling of God, the very revelation of God, the expression of God. What a joy, what a joy. God, we offer thanksgiving to God in his Son. So our praises, our spiritual sacrifices, our adoration, our worship is always going to God in a Son, because the Son is the means, is the one in whom the Father is pleasing. We honor God in his Son. We pray to God in his Son. We meditate on God in his Son. We worship God in his Son. What a joy. We worship in reverence to God in his Son. We behold God in his Son. We meditate on God in his Son, because God is made real to us through the very person of the Lord Jesus Christ. All the Father has and is, the Son has and is. So we cannot separate who the Father is from who the person, who the person of the Son, because everything the Father is to us is through the very being of the Son. Because the Father, we could say, dwells in unapproachable light, but he has made himself approachable to us in his Son. God in his Son is the Spirit. God in his Son is our Abba Father. God in his Son, I am in the Father and the Father in me. I am in the Father and the Father in me. So every part of our worship and praise is going to God in his Son for what he has done for us and what he keeps doing. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Reconciling the world to himself, not attributing their sin to them. But of course, let me read the 2 Corinthians chapter 5. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Verse 19. To this way that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and had committed unto us the word of reconciliation. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. God is nothing to us outside his Son. Everything he is to us is through the very person of his Son. God in his Son is the eternal word of God. God dwells in his Son. God dwells in us in his Son. It is through his Son that God dwells in us. Every everything. God fellowships with us in His Son. God fellowship with God in His Son is our glory. God in His Son is our refuge. God in His Son is our light. God in His Son is our King. God in His Son is our shepherd, is our strength, is our wisdom, is our power. God in His Son is our life. God in His Son is our deliverer. God in His Son is our righteousness. We don't have a righteousness of our own. God in His Son is our wisdom. What a joy. God in His Son is our abode. God in His Son is our Savior. What a joy. God in His Son is our Savior. God sanctifies us in His Son. God speaks to us in His Son. God speaks to us. Without the Son, God cannot reach man. Man cannot reach God. Everything God is to us is through His Son, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. The Son is the visibility of God. What a joy. The person of God is not separate from the person of the Son. If we meet the Son, we are meeting God. When the Son walks, it is as one indwelt by the Father. When the Son speaks, it is as one in whom is the Father. So let's not think that the Son is separate. The Son is not just the Son, but is the Son with the Father. The Son with the Father. What a joy. God will have no relationship with any creature except through His Son. It is always through His Son. It is in His Son God relates with us. God relates with us. God deals with us, with fallen man, with even the saved man, through the Son. God in His Son is our salvation. God in His Son is our salvation. The Son, we could technically say, is God in His approachable form. God in His approachable form. The Son is God from God. What the definition of the Son? The Son is God. God is only found in His Son. We will not find God outside the Son. What a joy to what the Father has done for us. Hallelujah to the Heavenly Father. Hallelujah to God the Son. Hallelujah to God the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.